Srimati N. Kritika Lakshmi, currently working as Associate Professor in Satyabhama University, Chennai. She has done her Bachelor of Architecture from Periyar Maniammai College of Technology for Women, Bharathidasan University, Trichy, and Postgraduate Diploma in Business Administration from ICFAI University, Hyderabad. She has also done Master of Architecture in Building Management from Satyabhama University, Chennai. She has been involving in developing and delivering lectures for undergraduates and postgraduate students using innovative teaching practices. She has attended several conferences and have made presentations in specialized subject area in architecture.
Welcome to UGC lecture series for Bachelor of Architecture on the subject Building Services. At this part, we will be dealing with sanitary waste and sewerage system. Particularly in this lecture, we are looking into common type of sanitation fittings, the urinals, wash basins, water closets and flushing systems. Apart from that, we also have the other sewer appurtenances like manholes and traps. So, urinals, it is a soil appliance. It is connected to a pipe after a suitable trap with adequate provision for flushing apparatus. So, it is a figure given here. This is the urinal and this is the flushing apparatus that we have here. So, these urinals, they come in different forms and shapes, but for classification we can have basically two categories. One is the bowl type or basin urinals and the stall type or slab type urinals. So, this bowl urinals are used for private use, and stall type we see in the public buildings. In stall type, we will have partitions in between them. So, these partitions and slab at the back, the slab at the back in the sense here, they are either of slate or marble, and the bowl is made of porcelain. So, totally it has to be impervious and a very smooth material, so that it is easier to clean and maintain. And they may be flushed like a closet. Generally, it is provided with automatic flushing systems. When you go for stall type, that is in public buildings, you see there will not be a flushing system here, it will be automatic. So, every 10 or 15 minutes, automatically it will be flushing here. Otherwise, they use sensors in urinals. So, after the person use the urinals, the flushing will automatically take place. But there is also this model where you have a flushing apparatus which can be operated manually. Next is your wash basin. So, a wash basin is similar to our sink, but it is provided, wash basin will be provided again with two taps, one for the cold water, one for the hot water. But it, depending on the climate, you may also have only one tap for cold water. Yeah, wash basins also come in various shapes, types and various types of installations. It can be like wall mounted, that what we say is like it will be fixed to the wall, or it can be pedestal mounted where it is fixed to the floor. So, when you take the wash basin, here is the mouth of the outlet. So, when you see inside the wash basin, you can see a actually see the in this picture I can show you that there is a outlet where you have a grating. So, this grating will be brass or nickel. So, this is to stop any large substances going into the pipeline, and this outline pipe discharges through a trap. So, here you have the trap, this discharges to a trap to the exterior lines. So, here you have the water supply line that is coming inside, and it will be connected to the tap here. This valve here, this controls the water, incoming water. This is the elbow. Elbow is something that connects the trap to the outlet connection, and this is the drain pipe we see here. Then coming to water closet. So, water closet is basically, it is a bowl to receive the excretory matter, and it has a trap and a flushing apparatus. So, all these things together we call the water closet, and sometimes people also call wherever we have a water closet, the whole room is also called as a water closet. So, it is recommended always to provide an ablution tap adjacent to the water closet, preferably on the right hand side wall, because mostly people are right hand users. So, ablution tap also is recommended to give. So, coming to the classification, you have two major types, which is Indian type water closet and European water closet. This is a model of an Indian type water closet. Most of us would have come across this. So this is fixed at the floor level where you have a squatting or sitting position. It is usually made of porcelain and it has a pan and the trap are separate in this water closet. So the thing is like the excreta will not directly fall into the trap. So what happens is there is a more possibility of the excreta to become foul when it is in the pan. So if it is not flushed properly, it will be a problem in this type of a water closet. Then you have the European water closet. European water closet is like sitting on a chair. That is how you use that. This is also completely made of porcelain. You have a seat and a cover for the closet. So you see here, this is a closet. This you have a seat and a cover, and it is usually having a flushing apparatus. So this particular water closet, the advantage is that the excretory matter will directly fall into the trap. So there is less chances of the pan being not unclean. So the pan is always clean. When you have one flush itself, it is mostly clean. Then we have the flushing cistern. Flushing cistern is to flush water closets and urinals, you always have a flushing cistern that is very necessary to install. So this is like when you see, you will have a handle for this, and when you just pull down the handle or press down, sometimes it will be on top of the cistern, or when you press down or pull up the handle, depending on the type of the cistern, the flushing will happen. And the position of this flushing cistern will be generally 2 meters for like for urinals, and for even this Indian water closet, people have used a flushing apparatus. So that will be 2 meters from the floor level. For EWC, that is European water closet, even 600 mm from the floor level is enough. The picture which we saw earlier is a proof for that. So what are this? There are 4 main parts in the flushing cistern. It works on the principle of siphon. So the major parts are the bell connecting the flush chain. So if you see here, there is a bell here. This is a form of a bell, so we call it as a bell. It is connected to the flushing chain. This is the flushing chain. This is the handle that we pull to flush the water. So this is the for the major part. Then you have a float in this. This is the float. It's a ball float. We call it, because it's in the form of a ball, it is called as a ball float. Then we have a inlet and outlet, and then you have the casing. Casing is the enclosure. So how it actually works is, when you pull this handle down, it actually lifts this bell. So when the bell is lifted here, there is a vacuum. So the vacuum is shifted and the water will flow inside, and this is the inlet pipe. So the vacuum will push the water inside and the flushing happens here. So once all the water is drained out, for that only we have this ball float here. This will keep on going down, and once it reaches the bottom, the inlet pipe water will come in automatically, and when it has come here, the inlet will stop. So that is a to control the inlet pipe is the major purpose of this ball float. So this is how a flushing cistern works. Now coming to manholes. So whatever fittings we were looking into, these are all the interior fittings which comes inside the building, inside the bathroom or the toilets. Now we'll be looking into the fittings which is outside the building, like the manholes and traps and all those things which we generally don't see in our day-to-day basis, that we don't notice it generally. So what is a manhole? It is a construction basically. It is made to connect the ground level with the hole or the opening made in the sewer line. See, sewer lines are going to be laid under the ground. So this ground level should be connected to the sewer, then only you can dispose the sewage. So they'll make a construction so that the hole in the sewer line and the ground is connected. So that is what we call it as a manhole. So the main objectives of a manhole is, a man should be easily and conveniently and safely should enter through it, because for cleaning or for inspection purposes, he should be able to enter it and carry out the usual maintenance operations. And if there is any obstruction in the sewage, it generally gets collected up in the manhole. So this manholes will be used to take out all the obstructions in the sewage. Then you have joining of the sewers. So this is a manhole is the place where different sewers will be connected in one point. So there also what happens is, if there is going to be a change in the direction or alignment, we need manholes in that place. Then manhole covers we have, it will be perforated. So, the undesirable gases and all will be coming out of it. So, this is a natural ventilation process also. So, the sewer lines will be naturally ventilated by these manhole covers. Then facilitate the layer of sewer lines in convenient lengths. So, you need not be restricted to like from starting to end, you cannot have pipe lengths. So, these manholes serve as a help us to break down the lines and we can connect the pipes or laying the sewer lines is easier that way. So, location of manhole. So, where and all can you have these manholes? It is always provided at every bend, junction, change of gradient or diameter. So, whenever there is going to be a bend in the line or two or more lines are coming and forming a junction, and when you are going to change the gradient or the pipe size, that is the diameter means diameter of the pipe, there you have they will provide the manholes. The sewer line between two consecutive manholes is laid straight. The straight alignment of sewer line also requires manholes at regular levels. So, when you are going to have two consecutive manholes in one sewer line, it should be laid straight. I mean, it has to be in line. So, the alignment of the sewer lines also depends on this manhole. So, it has to be kept at regular intervals. So, when you align the manholes, the sewer lines automatically get aligned. Now, coming to the design principles. Some few principles we have to follow when you are constructing a manhole. First thing, it should be structurally stable because it's going to be underground. So, it should be strong enough to resist whatever forces that is going to come upon them. And it should allow the sewage to flow smoothly and easily. So, there should not be any unnecessary foul in the manhole. The sewage wastewater or sewage should not stagnate in the manhole. So, it should be constructed so that it is flowed, it does not stay behind, because if it stays there will be foul in the manhole. And it should be safe for the workers to enter. Safe for the workers to enter in the sense, the if there is no foul, there will be unnecessary gases will not get accumulated. So, this it will not affect the workers who go inside for the maintenance. Then the walls and floors of the manhole should be impervious, like it has to be coated with cement plaster. Impervious means water should not seep from the manhole to the outside, because it might contaminate the water table also in some places depending on the depth of the manhole. So, it has to be impervious. If inlet and outlet sewers are different diameters, crown should be kept nearly the same level. The crowns in the sense the topmost of the sewer, the manhole level, if the diameters are going to be different, it has to be kept in the same level. So, you can achieve this by having a necessary slope. So, this will prevent any backflow of the sewage. Now, coming to the classification, you can actually classify based on the depth only. There is no other classification because it is man-made thing. So, it is shallow manhole, normal or medium, and deep manhole. So, what is a shallow manhole? When the depth of the manhole is about 750 mm to 900 mm. So, we call it as a shallow manhole. It is generally used in the beginning of branch sewers places where there is no heavy active traffic. When there is very light traffic, there you can use a shallow manhole. So, this is also called as an inspection chamber, and the cover will be a very light cover. Light cover in the sense the weight of the manhole cover will be less. Then you have the normal or medium manhole. This will be about 1500 meters, that is 1.5 meters depth will be there for this manhole, and the size will be like 1 meter by 1 meter or 0.8 meters by 0.8 meters if it is going to be a rectangle or square in shape. Whatever the shape you take up, the section is not reduced, only the depth of the manhole will be different. This particular manhole will have a heavy cover at the top. The top will be weight of the manhole cover will be more. Deep manhole. This will be more than the depth of the manhole goes more than 1.5 meters and the size of the manhole, the section of the manhole also increases, then we call it as a deep manhole. This manhole will be like the upper portion will be reduced and there will be an offset in that. So, you can see it in this picture. So, this is a deep manhole. So, you see in the top portion it is recessed, like it is narrow, and then you have a working chamber, we call this working chamber. Here you have a broader area. This is like it's a facility to go down and up to the bottom, And this will have a very heavy cover. This manhole will have a very heavy cover. And coming to the components of manholes generally, you will have an access shaft. That is a major thing. This is an access shaft. Then you have the working chamber. And this is called a benching. Then this is your branch saw, which is coming into the manhole. The walls. And you have the concrete base for the manhole. And you will have the steps or rungs or the ladder to climb up and down. This is the offset. We do it using the brick arch or corbelling. We use that. So there are major six parts is access shaft, bottom or invert, that is the benching. Then you have the cover with frame, steps or ladder, walls and the working chamber. So access shaft, this is the upper portion of the deep manhole. For rectangle, it will be 750 by 600 mm. And if it's going to be circular, the diameter will be 600 mm to 750 mm. Now, this depth, only the circumference we can say, but the depth depends on the depth of the manhole. Depending on this, proportionately that will be done. This access shaft, it can also be later converted as a working chamber. Like if you remove this wall and you put it here, then this whole thing will become a working chamber. The bottom or the invert. So, this is the, it is constructed by cement concrete or big paving will be done here. As I told you, the sewage water should not stagnate here. So, this has to be smooth and it has to be free flowing. So, it has should have suitable gradient. This thing, the semicircular or U-shape will be maintained here and the sloping sides will facilitate the entry of sewage to the main channel easily. This thing is called benching and you have the branch sewer here. Now, cover with frame. So, this is provided here. So, this is the cover. This perforation is shown here. This is your manhole cover. This is provided at the top and it is made of cast iron. The depth of this frame will be 200 mm to 250 mm and the base will be about 100 mm wide. This will be embedded. The frame will be embedded in the pavement and the cover will rest on top of that. Because the cover alone we can remove and use it. Now, this weight of the cover and frame depends on the traffic that is going to subjected to this cover. So, and it has to be standardized. The covers, whatever manhole covers we are giving, it has to be standardized because in future or if there is any repair or damage or even if it gets stolen because it is cast iron, it should be easily replaceable. And the top of the thing, because it is iron metal, it should be rough edges, should, rough surface should be given so that it is not slippery. Then we come to the steps of the ladder. This is for easy access in and out of the manhole. It is made of cast iron. And generally it is staggered, like when you take up the center 200 mm, it is staggered this way and that way. But if the width is double, you need not stagger it. It can be normal steps. And when the depth is going to be more, a ladder is more preferable than a staircase, because when the depth is going to be more, people tend to climb down using a ladder. They feel that convenient than getting down by steps. Then the walls. So, the walls can be made of brickwork, stonework or cement concrete. It can be either or. But brick walls are generally common for manholes. And the minimum thickness for brick walls, it will be 200 mm. If you are going to use concrete, cement concrete for the walls, it can, the thickness can be even more or less. Now, the working chamber. This is where, this is the lower portion of the deep manhole where people are going to work there. So, what we have to do is, this is giving the space for carrying out the maintenance, that is cleaning or inspection of the sewer line, all those things happen here. So, people have to stand here and work. So, the height, the clearance should be 1.8 meters. And the minimum size for this kind of chamber will be, like if it is going to be square or rectangular, will be 0.9 meters by 1.2 meters. And if it is going to be circular, it will be 1.2 meters in diameter. Now, the next thing will be traps. This is the another important fitting in sanitation. A trap is a depressed or bent sanitary fitting, which always remains full of water. So, this is what a trap looks like. This is actually a P-trap. So this is the entry and this is going to be the outlet. So in between this, there is a water. This is what we call it as seal, water seal. So this water seal, it is measured from the, it's a vertical distance between the crown and the dip of the teeth. So this distance is the seal, dip, this is the dip of the tap. So this is the water seal. This water seal, the measurement is important because depending on the type of fitting you are going to use the trap, the depth of the seal will differ. So the trap will always have this water. This is a water seal. So the basic function of a trap is to prevent the foul gases entering into the rooms or the areas where you have the fittings. So it is to prevent the passage of foul air or gases through it. Through the trap, the foul gases should not come inside. So for that only we use this water seal. So what are the requirements when you use a trap? What are the requirements for a good trap is? It should be capable of being easily cleaned. There should be, it should be regularly cleaned because it has a bent shape there. So it should be able, we should be able to easily clean it. It should be easily fixed with the drain. You should be able to fix it with the drain. Free from any projections inside the trap, there should not be any projections because it will obstruct the passage of the flow of sewage. And it should be very simple in construction and it should have a self-cleansing property. It should also possess adequate water seal to fulfill the purpose of its installation. That's what I will do. Depending on the type of installation, the depth of the shield, seal, water seal will vary and it has to have adequate water seal depending on the installation. The internal external surfaces should be of smooth finish. Whatever the trap is, the internal and external should be of smooth finish for easy flow of the wastewater or solid waste. Now, coming to the classification, according to the shape and the use, you have two types. According to the shape of the trap, you call it as P trap, Q trap and S trap. And according to the use, you have the floor trap, gully trap and the intercepting trap. So, when you say P trap, it's in the shape of the letter P. So, this is a P trap. So, you see it's in the letter P shape. So, that's why it's called a P trap. And the main thing is like the legs will be at right angle to each other. So, this is what is a P trap. So, when you say Q trap, again the shape of the trap is going to be Q shape. It's going to be a Q kind of shape. But here the angles will not be at right angles because it will be a different angle because of the shape. Now coming to the S trap, the trap will look like S in shape. And here the legs are parallel. You can see here and here the legs are parallel, so it forms a S shape. So this is why these traps are called Q, P and S. Now depending on the use, if you see we have floor traps. Floor traps is like it is made of cast iron and it is put in the point of entry of the installations. Basically, the floor traps, you can see it in bathrooms, kitchens and underneath the sinks and wash basins, you can see this floor traps. It is embedded into the floor. So, this is the starting point of wastewater flow. So, the other sanitary fittings, whichever we see, this is a collecting point. And this is the starting point from where the wastewater starts to flow. So, in a floor trap, you see, you will have a grating at the top. And then this is the water seal and the thing gets collected here and goes to the sullage pipe. So, this grating as a cover, this can be removable. The purpose of this grating is any large substances should not go inside because if it is going to be large, it will choke the pipe. So, this grating is provided for that purpose and this can be removed and then you can clean it if you need to. Then the gully trap. This is generally made of stoneware or cast iron. The floor traps, nowadays it comes in stainless steel and plastics also. But gully traps are made of stoneware and the grating on the top is provided by cast iron. This fitting is always found inside a masonry chamber. And it is a starting point of horizontal flow. So, you can see this only always on the exterior of this. So, this is your floor level and your grating is here. And this gray color thing is your gully trap. So, this is situated near the external face of the wall. you keep it slightly higher or in line with the pavement. This will either directly lead to the sewer or to the inspection chamber or to the manhole. So it can be anything, but this is not necessarily the end point of your building's drainage system. So this is what a gully trap looks like. So when you see here, you can see there it can serve two or three connections at a time. But we have to make sure that when we connect, we separately connect the sewage water and the soil waste. We don't want to mix the sewage and soil water. That is not advisable. Intercepting trap. This is the final trap which will convey the sewage to the public sewer. So this is going to be the final point of sewage system for a building. This is usually found inside a manhole. So this will particularly have a seal of 100 mm because this is as the maximum water seal, because the foul gases from the public sewer line should not enter the premises. So this is how it usually inside the thing you can see. Now this will have an inspection arm. So this is the intercepting trap. You have the manhole cap here. The inflow is this way. And this is the intercepting inspection arm, we call it. It will have a plug here, and you have the rodding arm, and this goes to the sewer. Now this whole thing is your intercepting trap. Now this is inside the manhole. So as I told, it has an inspection arm for cleaning and inspection. So we go inside the manhole, and this arm only we use for cleaning and for inspecting if there is any blockage or anything. This is closed by a plug or a cock. There should be a fresh air inlet. This is the fresh air inlet, should be there for this manhole. So in this lecture we understood what are the various sanitary fittings there, and how, what is the working principles of it, and the fundamentals. Sanitary fittings, we covered urinals, wash basins, water closets, and all those things. The manholes, they are very important for sewage disposal. So what is the role of manholes, the basic principle, working principle of a manhole, and the different types of manholes were discussed. And then the need for traps, what are the good requirements for a good trap, and again the various different types of traps also was elaborated in this lecture. And the possible questions are, what are the common sanitary fittings we use in a residence? Explain any two sanitary fittings with this working principle, they can ask like that. And describe manhole in detail, so you'll be, and then elaborate the role of traps in sanitation. These are the probable questions, and with this we conclude this lecture. We'll meet in the next. Thank you.